Today is Good Shepherd Sunday. All of our texts have something to say about Jesus as, or speak about shepherds, lambs, or Jesus as the Good Shepherd, or the Lamb who was slain, who was on the throne. We're going to look at our second lesson from the book of Revelation today for the sermon. In our prayers, you're going to hear, and you have been hearing, the name Lyle Dolly for several months. Lyle has a neurological disorder that they have, that so far is undiagnosed. He's supposed to get a diagnosis, he hopes, next week. It seems almost like Lou Gehrig's disease. He keeps losing strength. But Lyle had a heart attack on Saturday. They put a stent in. It was a mild heart attack, so I expect him to be on the mend. And then last night, Ellen LeSant fell and broke her leg again. So she'll be in our prayers. I invite you to prepare your hearts for worship through the brief order of confession and forgiveness found on the third page of your bulletin. Please rise. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the fountain of living water, the rock who gave us birth, our light, and our salvation. Let us come into the light, the revealing and healing light of God. God of grace and glory, you have brought us through the night of sin into the light of Jesus' resurrection. Yet our lives are still shadowed by sin. Make us alive in Christ, O God. Make us new as you make all things new. Rescue us from evil and the gloom of sin. Renew us in grace and restore us to living in your holiness. Through Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen. Rejoice with all creation around God's throne. The light of the risen Christ puts flight to all evil deeds, washes away sin, restores innocence to the fallen, casts out hate, brings peace, and humbles earthly pride. Jesus Christ loves you and frees you from your sins by his blood. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Share God's peace by greeting those around you.
Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
O God of peace, you brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep. By the blood of your eternal covenant, make us complete in everything good, that we may do your will and work among us all that is well-pleasing in your sight. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you. A reading from Acts. Now in Joppa there was a disciple whose name was Tabitha, which in Greek is Dorcas. She was devoted to good works and acts of charity. At the time she became ill and died. When they had washed her, they laid her in a room upstairs. Since Lydda was near Joppa, the disciples who heard that Peter was there sent two men to him with the request, "Please come to us without delay." So Peter got up and went with them, and when he arrived, they took him to the room upstairs. All the widows stood beside him, weeping and showing tunics and other clothing that Dorcas had made while she was with them. Peter put all of them outside, and then he knelt down and prayed. He turned to the body and said, "Tabitha, get up." Then she opened her eyes, and seeing Peter, she sat up. He gave her his hand and helped her up. Then calling the saints and widows, he showed her to be alive. This became known throughout Joppa, and many believed in the Lord. Meanwhile, he stayed in Joppa for some time with a certain Simon, a tanner. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Reading from Revelation. After this I looked, and there was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, robed in white with palm branches in their hands. They cried out in a loud voice, saying, "Salvation belongs to our God who is seated on the throne and to the Lamb." And all the angels stood around the throne, and around the elders and the four living creatures. And they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, singing, "Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, "Who are these robed in white, and where have they come from?" I said to him, "Sir, you are the one that knows." Then he said to me, "These are they who have come out of the great ordeal. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. For this reason, they are before the throne of God and worship him day and night within his temple. And the one who is seated on the throne will shelter them. They will hunger no more and thirst no more. The sun will not strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of the water of life. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 10th chapter. At that time, the festival of the dedication took place in Jerusalem. It was winter, and Jesus was walking in the temple in the portico of Solomon. So the Jews gathered around him and said to him, How long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Messiah, tell us plainly. Jesus answered, I have told you, and you do not believe me. The works that I do in my Father's name testify to me, but you do not believe because you do not belong to my sheep. My sheep hear my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. What my Father has given me is greater than all else, and no one can snatch it out of the Father's hand. The Father and I are one. The Gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. I would like to invite the children to come up. Good morning. In our gospel lesson today, by the way, somebody, it appears, took my earbuds I had in the pulpit, because I was going to have you listen to my phone. In our gospel lesson today, it says, Jesus is our good shepherd, and we are his sheep, and his sheep know his voice. And that's why I thought it was such a good idea to have those earphones, because you listen to your phone, don't you? Don't you guys listen to books on the phone? Like this book? Let's see. Don't you listen to books like that on your phone? You don't. Well, I listen to books on the phone, and it helps to have those earphones on because I can focus on that voice on the phone. Well, Jesus, our good shepherd, says his sheep know his voice. Do you know how sheep know a voice? How many of you have pets? Do they come when you call them? No? They don't know your voice yet. There's a famous court case in Australia where a man was being accused of stealing a sheep. And the man's defense was, I can't steal that sheep. It's my sheep to begin with. So the judge took them outside and they put the sheep at one end of the courtyard. Then he asked the man who said it was his sheep and accused the other of stealing to call his sheep. And the sheep didn't move. And then he asked the other man who was accused of stealing to call the sheep. And sure enough, the sheep came running. Do you know why? The sheep knew his owner's voice. Well, as we grow, we learn the voice of Jesus. Okay? You know what the most important thing he tells us? God loves us. God cares for us, and that nothing can ever snatch you out of God's hands. You belong to Him. Isn't it nice knowing you belong to Jesus? I think so. Let us pray. Repeat after me. Gracious God, we thank you for Jesus. Help us to hear. Most importantly, we thank you that we belong to Him. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You can go back to your seats. Okay. Good Shepherd and tears. We're going to get through this. This is for the next service. Tears. We're going to talk about tears today. The reason is the promise in this text, at the end, you've got all these people, throngs of people, myriads and myriads standing before the throne of God up in heaven. Their robes are white. They've been washed in the blood of the Lamb, so of course they'd be white. We might think they'd be red, but the whole idea is, John is trying to convey, they're white because we're washed, clean, white. They're waving palm branches, hopefully more enthusiastically than we wave palm branches on Palm Sunday, because it's a big celebration. It's a triumph of God. The people are standing there before the throne, and the Lamb is on the throne. The Lamb who was slain, who knows the ordeal that people have gone through, especially many people of faith. 130 countries, by the way, have laws either banning or greatly restricting Christianity in this world. Christians are persecuted throughout the world. And little is said about that in the press. And then it says, and God Almighty comes and wipes away every tear from the eyes of those who stand before the throne. Tremendous picture and a tremendous words of comfort. Let's talk about tears for a minute. Did you know that you produce 30 gallons of tears a year, 10 ounces a day? It's a lot of tears. Here's the most important thing. There's all kinds of good things about tears. How many of you, if you're able to cry, if you've had a good cry, you feel better? All kinds of reasons about that, the emotions that are released. But tears release toxins from the body. It's an actual scientific fact. The tears that are produced by stress help the body get rid of chemicals that raise cortisol, the stress hormone. It makes us feel better to cry, to release those tears. Truly, it has been said, sit next to anybody, and you're sitting next to someone who has a pool of tears next to them. We all certainly have experienced those experiences that cause us stress, grief, tears. Revelation 7, we've got that great multitude, and the person giving the revelation, Jesus Christ himself, asks the seer, John, the writer, who are these people? John is mystified by that question. And he says, Lord, you know. These are the people who have been through the great ordeal. More than just merely life, although we certainly have our ordeals in life, do we not? But those also who understand that taking a stand as people of faith, they have been persecuted. Scripture is filled with people who have gone through times of tears. Let me just read you a few that I could remember. Hagar wept. That was, of course, Abraham's wife, his concubine, his servant, who became his concubine and had Ishmael. Esau wept. Jacob wept. Samson's wife wept. Jonathan and David wept with each other. David wept when Jonathan died. Elijah wept. The people of Israel sat down and wept when in Babylon, and they remembered Zion. Peter wept bitterly when he denied Jesus. Mary Magdalene wept at Jesus' tomb. Paul, who is not often portrayed as an emotional person, wept, was wept over, and he challenged Christians to weep with those who weep. He thanked the Ephesian elders and testified to serve them with tears for 3 years. Tears. The promise that God Almighty will wipe them off of our eyes. God Himself. So this great multitude. Let me tell you about the Hiddy people. And what was great about this great multitude? They were washed in the blood of the Lamb. They were there not because of anything that they had done, but everything that God had done in Christ. The Hiddy people, I tried to find out how to pronounce that, and I did not come up with anything. So Hiddy is the name I'm going to use. This is a story from Wycliffe Bible Translators. Lee Bramlett was working with the Hiddy people. And, of course, when you're going to translate Scripture into an indigenous language, you have to find out what the words are. So love is a big word. So Lee Bramlett asked a group of men, many of them the elders in the tribe, asked them if he could help them understand how to translate love. Verbs ended in vowels, I, A, or U. Love was duvi or duva. But they didn't have a third word for love. So he asks this group of men, can a man duva his wife? And they said, oh, yes. First he asked, could you duvi your wife? Yes, they said. That would mean that the wife had been loved, but the love was now gone. And he didn't give a reason for that love being gone, but when he asked, can you duva your wife? They said, yes, but that kind of love depended upon the wife's actions. She would be loved as long as she remained faithful and cared for her husband well. As long as she would get the husband water and anything the husband asked for. So then he said, okay, could you duvu your wife? And everyone laughed and said, of course not. If you said that, you would have to keep on loving your wife, no matter what she did. Even if she never got you water, never made you meals, even if she committed adultery, you would be compelled to just keep on loving her. No, we would never say duvu to our wife. It just doesn't exist. So then, Lee Bramlett sat there in silence with the men, and he asked, could God duvu people? And they sat there in silence. And then tears started rolling down their faces. Finally, they responded, do you know what this could mean? It would mean that God would keep loving us over and over, millennia after millennia, even when we rejected His love he would be compelled to love us. It brought tears to their eyes. Well, this text from Revelation 7, this view of heaven, the myriads of people standing around God's throne, saying, "Blessing and honor and glory and might belongs to the Lamb." Why? Why does it belong to the Lamb? Because the Lamb, who's on the throne, has been through everything that we could imagine we could go through. Suffering, death, tears. And the Lamb has been through that, the Lamb who was slain, who now washes us clean. And God keeps on loving us. By the way, this is Ted asking the question. There's a lot of things I don't understand about Jesus. And the answer is, but Jesus is committed to you regardless. And Ted goes, that's what I don't understand. Isn't that exactly what this text is telling us? God is committed to us regardless. Oh, that is what I don't understand. So tears, when they come, realize that they're a good thing. And realize that the very good shepherd that we can know his voice speaks to us loudest through our tears. Frederick Buechner said this, "Whenever you find tears in your eyes, it is well to pay the closest attention. They are not only telling you something about the secret of who you are, but more often than not, God is speaking to you through them of the mystery of where you have come from and is summoning you to where, if your soul is to be saved, you should go next." Tears, a good thing. Jewish midrash, or interpretation, talks about Adam and Eve being expelled from the garden, but God gave them a gift as they were expelled. The gift was the gift of tears. And here was the promise. "When grief overtakes you and your heart aches beyond enduring and great anguish grips your soul, then there will fall from your eyes this tiny tear, and your burden will grow lighter." Well, today, we see the throng in heaven who is there not because of any great thing they have done, but they were saved through the great ordeal. Tears, anguish, suffering, pain. But God in Christ saved them. And now they stand before God's throne, waving palm branches, celebrating. Blessing and honor and glory and might. Just what we sang today. Be to God and the Lamb forever. Amen.
Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Rooted in the abundant life and love of Christ Jesus, we pray for the life of the church, the lives of people in need, and the life of all creation. Holy and mighty God, in Christ our shepherd, you call your church to hear your voice and to continue the good works that Christ does in the Father's name.
As we follow, help us to invite all hurting people into your family. Lord, in your mercy.
Gracious God, before your throne is an uncounted multitude from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages.
Guide the leaders of the nations of earth toward the reconciliation of all peoples from different races and cultures and faiths, that we may walk in your ways of peace. Hunger or thirst no more, and fear no evil. Lord, in your mercy.
God of healing, respond to the call of people who cry out in loneliness or despair.
Dry the tears of those in chronic pain or illness, especially Terry Carlson, Lyle and Lucy Dolly, Sandy Drake, Ron Fells, Jeff Hempel, Ralph Hurley, Paula Merkley, Norma Mueller, Stan Nelson, Bennett Shanks, and Ellen Lassant. Are there any others?
We commend to your salvation those who have walked through the valley of death and have come out of the great ordeal.
Embrace with your compassion those who mourn. Lord, in your mercy.
Compassionate God, let the voice of the Good Shepherd be heard everywhere.
With your very presence, sustain communities that are formed out of common struggle, among those who are widowed, among children without parents, and among people who have no permanent shelter. Lord, in your mercy. We deliver all this into your care, O God, trusting in the work of your Holy Spirit to bring all things into the risen life of Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, ruler of heaven and earth. Day by day you shower us with blessings. As you have raised us to new life in Christ, give us a glad and generous heart, ready to praise you and to respond to those in need. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, for the glorious resurrection of our Savior, Jesus Christ, the true Paschal Lamb who gave himself to take away our sin, who in dying has destroyed death, and in rising has brought us to eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter and the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, and with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join in their unending hymn. Holy, in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. All is ready. Our Lord invites us. Please come. You may be seated.
Thank you.
The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Give you thanks, O God, that you make your home with us, bringing heaven to earth in this holy meal. Fill us with your Spirit as we go from here, that we may wipe away tears, tend to those in mourning and pain, seek the healing of nations, and bring to earth the presence of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
A couple of things. The Palooza, the visit by the bishop, is going to be this afternoon from 3 to 5, so keep that in mind. Hope you saw the newsletter yesterday. It was yesterday, wasn't it, Danny? Danny was on the front page. Great article about Danny and his work with... Except where's that Messiah t-shirt? Hey, Cassie.
I have a sheet that talks about the committees, so I'm just pointing this out. We've given you some of this information before, but we have been working hard based on the feedback that we've gotten from the surveys to improve communication and organization. So this is where we are right now. On the first, the ministry strands and where the committees fall under that. And then the council reps that are associated with each committee. There's also a description of the committees, and this list is a little bit different than the one you were given back at the annual meeting because we've made some modifications and revisions after we've really looked at what we need here. And on the back, this is a question that I've been getting. These are the teams that are under each of the committees. And right now, we have council working hard, trying to get some people that are really passionate about these areas and being the committee chairs. And you can see who has volunteered so far for the committee chairs. And we thank you very much to those people. You see there are also some blank spaces on some of those committee chair positions. And we have... We're asking, but if you pray about it and feel that you are led to try to be a chair for the committee, we would love to hear from you. Your council rep is on there. You can also contact me. I know when we first started going here, one of the things that we did right away was get involved stuff, some organizations, some classes. I really was blessed. I felt a big part of the church family, met some amazing people, so I encourage you, if you're not involved, to look at this, pray about it, and see if there's a spot where you become a bigger part of this. Thank you.
Thank
you. Sorry. One thing. Sorry. One thing I forgot. Next 4 weeks, we are going to have the chairs and come up and give you a brief description of what they're doing, what their goals are. The next few weeks, I hope you can hear me. The next few weeks, you can look for those in Temple Talks at our services, so that way you can get an idea of what we're trying to do with these committees. So we're very excited about it, and we hope everyone will be part of something. Thank you.
Thank you. Margaret, are you going to say something about Vacation Bible School?
Yes.
Thank you. Why don't you stay up here and see if that helps.
I are working on getting Vacation Bible School planned in the absence of a staff person working on that. So if anybody would like to be participating in the planning of it, whether it's with decorations, any of the different stations, or just become a volunteer and show up and we'll tell you how we can help, please talk to one of us. We're going to be having a meeting hopefully in the next 2 weeks. And we'll
will look forward to seeing you. And if you are in the gardening area and you would like to do some gardening, please come and talk to me. We're going to think about making a community garden.
So I'd like to talk to you.
If you'd like to garden, see Margaret. Also, the Vacation Bible School, you can register. I don't. Is it up online yet? Okay, the midweek messenger will tell you how to register. All right, receive this benediction. Oh, let me explain one thing about the last hymn. It's not a particularly Lutheran hymn. It is based on Revelation 7 and 21, which is the vision of the people standing around the throne in heaven. It's a great hymn. Receive this benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Jesus reigns and heaven rejoices.
Jesus reigns, the God of love. Jesus reigns, the world alone. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah,
guided by the gospel, we go in peace, remember the poor.